Namaskaram. We have seen so far the narration of the story of Sarasvati Sindhu Hindu civilization. 8 topics. The topics are, which we have covered so far, are Samudra Manthanam, Geography and Polity, Trade, Wealth of Nations, Technology, Economy, Language and Culture. The last segment, the topic, takes a look at all these 7 topics and suggests that the principal sources of history are available to us today for narrating the history of the civilization from the 7th millennium before Common Era. So it no longer needs to be treated as a proto-history, because we have got primary sources of the inscriptions which have been deciphered, which can be used to narrate the life activities of the people of the so-called prehistorical times, which now become historical times on the civilizational area of India, that is Bharat. So, principal sources of history. So, we have got very beautiful maps prepared by Schwarzberg, indicating the artifacts of stone weapons and stone tools that were used in the so-called Stone Age, and the Indian sites which have exhibited the those days of the Stone Age. Then the Neolithic culture emerges in a number of parts of India, as seen in the map, again from the Schwarzberg Atlas, which shows the types of tools and parts, houseware that were used, and the tools they were working with during the both Neolithic and the Chalcolithic culture. Chalcolithic related only copper, and the tin bronze revolution brought in the alloying culture, the so-called Bronze Age, which I called the Tin Bronze Age, Tin Bronze Iron Age, Steel Age, Quaternary. Then we have got very beautiful mapping done in these maps of the post-Harappan and Iron Age pottery sites. They are all over the country. So again, we have to very clearly remember that when we talk of the Saraswati Sindhu civilization, we are not talking of the settlements of only these two river basins. We are talking of the support base that existed, which created the network of resources that were being supplied from all over Bharatam and all over the ancient Far East, and also the west of Sindhu from the present day Iran and Balochistan. They were also source suppliers of material. The Persian Gulf was also a source. So they were all integral part of the entire expanded civilizational area. It was a greater civilizational area of the Saraswati Sindhu civilization. So we have seen the spoked wheels. We have found terracotta spoked wheels in Banwali and Bhildana. The spokes are painted. They could be spindles, spindle walls, but they could also be representations of spoked wheels. Horse bones have been found from Surkotada in Kutch. We have a horse figurine found in Luthal and Mohenjo-daro. We have the horse head as a chess piece found in Luthal. So a small horse, and of course the Kara onager, also existed in the area. Sindh horse was very famous in the entire Eurasia. The organization of the artisans into guilds was a remarkable social engineering. It resulted in the emergence of a guild master, a fadkari, fadnis, a public officer, the keeper of the register of wealth accounting ledgers of a metals manufactory. That such a guild master is shown on a seal. Pictorial motif, the symbol or the indescript sign, is a squirrel, palm squirrel. The squirrel signifies Shrestri, flying squirrel. Rebus, Shrestri, guild master. Set, a banker, a merchant. Chetan, Pashto language, same, merchant. Plus car, a squirrel. Again, squirrel has got two words, Shrestri, car. Both signify guild master and metal worker. Kara, kare, kara, squirrel. Rebus, car, blacksmith. Thus the squirrel signifies a guild master of a blacksmith guild. This person becomes so important, he regulates the activities of the artisans and pulls them together into a coordinated effort in an organizational structure called the Sreni or the guild. We have a squirrel hieroglyph engraved as part of a text message on the Nindavari seal. A number of other seals have been found with the same palm squirrel symbol, who represents a guild master, Shrestri, set, car, blacksmith. Let us take a deeper look at the variants of this hieroglyph as a sign. And this sign, together with the ficus glomerata sign get embellished with two ligatures showing like 2 years of the sign. They also signify hieroglyphic representations. Kara is a year, Kar is a blacksmith, and the ligature with about three small little strokes signifies Kolom 3, Kolimi, Smithy, Forge. So these are signifiers, very clear symbols of workers of metalwork, lapidary work, working with jewels and gems, and with metals and alloys, working with Loha, metal, and also with the guild. So an organizational structure gets embellished, a metal components, a metal resources get embellished. These are two very unique symbols, those two unique ligatures, which are very important to note. So that means the scribe was very clearly trying to communicate the importance of these two categories, the metals as a resource and the artisans as a resource, who organized themselves into a guild. The guild became a major resource, a social organization which was creating wealth for the nation, which could be shared among the people. So that is the most important. So that, of course, the details of the decipherment can be seen with the with a number of words, expressions from almost all the Indian languages, which relate to these hieroglyphs of Loha, Glova, Ficus glomerata, and the Shastin Kar, the squirrel, the palm squirrel. Palm squirrel again is seen on a very beautiful seal, a seal impression in the Yupen Museum. It is from the Gad seals, seal number 18, where Gad clearly proved that the Indus script continued into the Ur area in Mesopotamia. So this is an Indus script seal found in Mesopotamia called the Gad seal number 18, showing a short horn bull and with three symbols, which are all Indus script hieroglyphs, signifying Rango, buffalo, Ranga, pewter tin, Muhammad, iron quantity acquired by Kolhe's smelters of equilateral lumps of little pointed crucible ingots, rosin shaped. Muh, rebus, muh, ingot. Ganda, four, rebus, kanda, metal implements. Thus, the signs of this seal signify equipment and ingots. Made by Karnaka with his spread legs, who is a scribe, who is a Karni, a supercargo, who is also a Karnaka, a helmsman. The magnificent signifier, Kar Shresti, squirrel, Rebus, Kar blacksmith, Shrestin, guildmaster. Aitareya Brahmana mentions this specific term, Shrestin, as a guildmaster. We have the tradition in Germany, the founder of the German people is called Twisto. I submit that the Twisto word comes from Twasta, Twastr, the artisan, Vishwakarman. Same person is shown with two torques on the pillar of the boatman in Paris, approximately 1st century common era, and also on the Gundestrup cauldron, silver cauldron, where these Indus-script skills are remembered and shown. This Twisto Twastra is the divinity venerated in the Rashtri Suktam of the Rigveda by Vagdevi rendering her Richa in praise of the Devata Atman, life principle and sensation. So this is the pillar of the boatman where the Karnadhara Kar. Karnadhara, the man wearing these torques on his ears, is a Karnadhara. Karnadhara Kar. Karnaka. Meluha, helmsman, blacksmith. He is signified by the hieroglyphs of the torques held on the ears. Singin horn, he is a horn person. Singikara, car, ear, car, loha car, blacksmith, iron worker, a farrier. Thus together, Singikar, ornament, goldsmith. So these signifiers are so profoundly recognized, they spread all over Europe. And this is as of date of 1st century common era, this pillar of the boatman has been set up in Paris. We have the seal of M101 seal with the field symbols of the young bull, the standard device, and the Poladu bird tagged together with the fish symbol to signify metalwork and working with steel. Poladu, Polad. Poladu, black drango, Polad, steel. the great long tablet also has a number of symbols which are a metalwork catalogues by the artisans and seafaring merchants who have documented and identified their activities and the products that they produced using these hieroglyphs. It's a brass relief tablet with remarkable features, remarkable documentation of the spine, then the pincer and a standing person, spread legs, a spoked wheel and so on. And of course the usually occurring karnika, the rim of a pot. So we have seen these symbols and we have got a person, water carrier, kuti, water carrier, kuti, smelter. We have seen the spine, which could be a barado, bharata, or it could be a karado, karad, alloy metal, hard alloy metal. Or it could be car, spine, car, blacksmith. The pincer, car, patakaru, car, blacksmith. So the karnaka, repeatedly we find these signs signifying very specific activities of the artisans working with wealth resources. Again, we see a variant of the rice plant is a sprout with five short strokes. Kolu is a sprout. Kolu is a wedge metal, And of course, we have the rim of a jar with inline stroke or a slash. A notch is kanda, rebus, kanda equipment. Slash is dhala, stroke, dhalako, large ingot. So ingots and equipment, ingot and equipment. Karnika, karnika is documenting ingots, equipment, metalwork. Again the bird within brackets, the bracket parenthesis as God observed is a split parenthesis, becomes the brackets. The bracket is a muha, a bun ingot, a lozenge shape, combined parenthesis without splitting. Muh, parenthesis, lozenge shape, rebus, muh, ingot, working with ingots. And the two bangles, kara, bangles, wristlets, rebus, kara, blacksmith. So every one of these symbols can be very clearly found out to be rebus representations of Meluha expressions. And when we say Meluha, we are referring to the commonly used form of the word, which is found in almost all the language families of our country. They are in Mundarika, they are in Santali, they are in Tibetan, they are in Indo-Aryan, and they are also in Dravidian. So all these languages carry variations of these words, these core Meluha words, which have a rebus rendering of wealth resource. So that is a categorical basis. That is why it has been detailed. So with a lot of words are involved in this slide, please go through them very carefully. You can very clearly see one feature. There was a unifying force of the Sprach Bund, the linguistic area or the speech union, where people from different language families were able to understand each other with variant pronunciations. So we can now see it even in dialects, even today. The dialectical speech of a worker sitting, working in a farm, and a literary person writing a poetry, or a chandas, or a richa. Very variation in pronunciation. So the pronunciation became a very important feature in the sacred process of working with the fire altar. So they called these people mispronunciation people. They are called the Meluha. They mispronounce, use ungrammatical language, but communicate message effectively in their speech, the dialectical speech, which can be seen in this beautiful two imageries from Dholavera and Mohenjo-daro, where a woman with breasts hanging down is ligated to a bull. So it's a ligature indicating what work she is doing. She is a decrepit woman, this is a dokra. You know, we have in India a tradition called the dokra kamar. They are the Serapadu masters who produce the Serapadu artifacts in Chhattisgarh, Bastar, Orissa. She is a dokra. She is a metalsmith. Dangar, bull, dangar, blacksmith. She is a blacksmith, but she is a specialist working with metal infusion and creating artifacts using Serapadu technique of the dogra tradition of bronze, brass, alloys, pachaloha. Look at the ornaments and then look at the fillet, the gold fillets that is worn on the forehead of the priest. And there are two pins shown on either end of this string of string necklace, they are like pens. They are writing pens. They are writing pens of that civilizational time. They are like needles, stitching needles. They were used for writing on metal using iron oxide paint. So these are the five such artifacts of pens that have been found, together shown together with the gold pendant in the Mohenjo-daro excavation report by John Marshall. The man wearing the fillet and the dotted circle on his forehead, and of course also on his right shoulder. The fillets are two types. One is a side fillet, another is a like a wave. So the ornaments. We have seen the fillets worn by the priests in archaeological finds. They are of different shapes. Patta, patti means a fillet. Patel is a village headman. So the pattas are investitures used in the investiture ceremony according to Satapada Brahmana. When the priests were involved, like the potra, potradara, hotra, nestru, they are all presented with shawls, with trefoils and other symbols, and also fillets with different symbols. Here we have two fillets. One is a fillet together with a dotted circle as worn by the Mohenjo-daro priest, and another fillet with a different shape like a wave, maybe signifying a particular type of priest or the 16 priests who are engaged in the performance of the Rajasuya or Vajapaya Yagna. They were all assayers of metal. They were anointed with these fillets after the performance of the ceremony, which produced the results of the Yagna. So, Mundikak priest wears a distinct fillet shape of this wave. Maybe he was a Hotra, the principal priest, working together with the organization of the other 16 priests, including Potra, Potadara, Dabat Potra. So this writing instrument, this pen that we see, is two used together with a carnoy rings, which are ink pots. The ink is ferrite oxide. This ink, the nib of this pen, which looks like a needle end, say a needle, suchi, is dipped into the iron oxide and written on metal. So this gold pen itself contains this inscription written down using the iron oxide, ferrite oxide. Four symbols, which signified that it was work related to Kanchu, bell metal, and working in a smithy, and with alloy metal and mineral ores. These are the symbols. They were written down in long hand using this pen. So they had writing instruments. They had the ink pot. They also had the writing pens. So the details are given here. The tank is a pen nib. Takasala is a mint. So the related words, related to the work of the metal workers and the mint workers, and the workers in gold and jewellery are all clearly recorded as hieroglyphs, either in the form of the artifacts themselves or in the writing they have written as inscriptions on these artifacts. Tankasali is a mint master. Tankasali is a mint master. Tankasal is a mint. So dual purpose instrument. It's a pen and also a needle. And he would wear it as an amulet on his necklace. Suchi is a needle. Suchi could be an indicator, a subject on which the inscription relates. Evidence of cursive writing we have seen on the gold pen. Kenoyer has reported the inscription that has been found on this, which can be read rebus as indescript hieroglyphs. So now we can summarize the entire story of these hieroglyphs and the indescript corpora. They have been put together into three volumes called the Epigraphia Indescript, which are integral components of the Epigraphia Indica. All these three volumes contain roughly about 8,000 inscriptions, which are all wealth accounting ledgers, metalwork catalogues, and working with resources of metals, alloys, minerals, mints, furnaces, organize themselves into guilds, guild masters, working with ores, steel, polad, pola, magnetite ore, IO fish, IS alloy metal, Kanda arrow, Kanda 4, Kanda equipment. We have the young bull, we have seen that, Kondo, fire trench with live coal, Agnikunda. So these have been brought together in three volumes of Epigraphia Indescript. Surprise, these hieroglyphs become professional calling cards. There are anthropomorphs that have been found in scores in the Ahichitra region, which is an extension of the Sarasvati Sindhu civilization area in the Ganga Yamuna Dobe. And one anthropomorph carries a Brahmi inscription together with the Indus script signified by the anthropomorph itself, which is bent horns of a ram, person with spread legs, Karnaka helmsman, and horns, bent horns of a ram, mend iron, an iron worker. And on the breast of the anthropomorph is shown the one-horned young bull, which you have seen is Kunda Singhin, fire altar, working with ornament gold. And on top of the head is the symbol of Varaha. Varaha we have seen is Badi, worker in iron and wood. So here is an anthropomorph which signifies the professional competence of this professional calling on this professional calling card of a worker in iron and wood, a turner, a worker in, with fire, sacred furnace, worker in iron, and a helmsman with a cargo boat. And this is overwritten with a Brahmi inscription, which refers to Majita Sadhya. Majita Sadhya in Brahmi expression signifies a member of a Baji boat people assembly, a community. A Janapada existed of these boat people. They call themselves Majita Sadhya. So this owner of this anthropomorph, a professional calling card, is a Majita Sadhya, member of a Maji boat people assembly. So the Brahmi inscription expanded on the semantics of the Indus-script hieroglyphs signified by the anthropomorph. It's an astonishing continuum of the language and writing system that continued into the historical periods. We do not know the exact date of the anthropomorph. It has not been found in an archaeological context. Its provenance is not firmly defined, but it is very clear that such anthropomorphs existed and have been found. We have the seals showing again, people jumping over, tumbling over a buffalo, the tumblers, tull, metal casters. This symbolization, this representation in Rebus readings of Meluhan with pictures of an arrow, kanda equipment, with a jag and an arch, kanda, a buffalo, rango, pewter, and a butting bulls, butting, mutti, mustika, goldsmith. So again and again, the hieroglyphs and Indus-script seem to signify a documentation of the wealth resources and wealth accounting ledgers maintained by the Karnika, the accountant. One tablet was found in Ganveriwala with a seated person in doing penance with an arch over his head. His kamata is a penance. Kamata is a mint. Arch is a manda. Arch. Manda is a warehouse. So the worshipper is Bata. Bata is a furnace worker. Similar person seated in a penance posture has been reported in a copper seal. Again, provenance is doubtful. Both Rick Willis and Vasant Shinde look upon this as a continuum of the Mohenjo-daro copper plate inscriptions, which can also be read in Meluha readings. Kamada penance, Rebus Kamata mint, code, horns, code, workshop, pair of fishes on the chest, Dula pair, Rebus Dul cast metal, Ayo fish, Rebus Ayas metal alloy, Aya iron, thus is a worker in Dula Aya cast metal alloy. Another Mohenjo-daro seal, 1181 is a square seal, depicts a nude male deity with three faces, Trust, Trisiras, Rigveda says. So is a Trusta. Tattar is a brass worker. Tattan, brass worker. Tattara. That is there evidenced in a number of languages of the Indian Sprachbund or the language union. He is wearing wristlets, Kara, Rebus, Kar is a blacksmith. He has a bunch of twigs on his headdress. Kuti is a twig. Atharvaveda, Rigveda, Kuti, smelter. It's a smelter, brass worker. Take a look at some narratives on the Indus seal. Here is the seal M300 presenting a narrative. The Indus script hieroglyphs are Manda, raised platform, stool, arch. Rebus reading, Manda, warehouse. Lova, Ficus glomerata leaf. Rebus, low, copper, iron, metal. Kara, wristlets, bangles that the adornment wears. Rebus, car, blacksmith, ironsmith. Dangra, bull, hoofs of bovine. Rebus, tanger, blacksmith. Then on the obverse of this tablet is Bagala, Pleiades. Rebus, Bagala, thou, seafaring vessel. Comparable prayer posture is seen on the Sitsamshi bronze, Louvre Museum, which narrates in an Akkadian Elamite inscription, I, Shilhak, Inshishanak, son of Shutruk Nanhunte, beloved servant of Inshishanak, king of Anshan and Susa, made a bronze sunrise. Bronze sunrise. The Rebus readings are Med, iron, Mundarika, Ho, Medith, iron, Santali, Med, copper, Slavic. The narratives continue on a number of seals and seal impressions, showing an arched, ficus glomerata structure, a tiger with an adornment in front, on the top the signs of a tree, a water carrier, and an X. All are hieroglyphs, and we have seen that M300 seal. Mandi is a kneeling position. Manda is a warehouse, workshop. Mada is a shrine. Mandir is a temple. Bari, roof. Bari, thatched roof. Vari, wrap, wind. Barai, carpenter. Bari, merchant. Bariya, merchant. Vadi, one who helps a merchant. Yamachandra, Desi and Ammamala, old Prakrat. So most of the Meluha words or the ancient Indian language words are all traceable to the Prakratam versions of the ancient language of the Sarasvati Sindhu civilization. Then the worshipper is a Bata, Rebus, Bata furnace. Rebus reading further continues, Batudu, a title of the five castes of artisans, artificers, or guilds of artificers, a carpenter, one who makes a god of his belly. Five categories of artificers are recognized in the Indian tradition. Panchalamu, the Punjab, the five river systems, five waters, the country north of India, between the foot of the Himalayas and the Chambal. Panchali, the daughter of the king of Panchala, a title of Draupadi, the wife of the five Pandu princes. So we are dealing with that Saptasindhu region, which includes the Panchanada or Panchala. So Vadla Bhattudu, again a variant of the Badi, Vadlangi, Vadlavadu, signifies a carpenter. Vadlangi Pitta is a woodpecker. So he is a Shirpi. He is a skilled artisan in the art of creation. He is a Silpin. He is also a tailor. Shilpamu, an art, any manual or mechanical art. Muchi is a carpenter. Padlangi is a carpenter, a weaver, Salavadu, Kasivadu, Silpasastram, a mechanical science, the science of architecture. So these were the trades and artificer activities that the people were getting engaged in. Then we have the signs which can be read as Rebus in the script, Kutila, bent, Rebus, Kutila, katil, bronze, 8 parts of copper and 2 parts of tin. So we are dealing with the tin bronze age, Ara, Ara Kota, brass, Ara spokes, Ara brass. The glyph of the rim of a jar is Karnaka, projection on the side of a vessel or a handle. Pali is called Karnaka, having ears or corners. Kanda Kanka is the Santali version. Rebus, furnace account, scribe. Kanda is a furnace. Kanda is a fire altar. Kan is a copper. Kanaka is one who digs, digger, excavator. Karanikamu, a clerk, a clerkship, the officer of Karanam or clerk. Karanam, Kulkarani, Desha Kulkarani. Karana means an act or a deed in Rigvedic times. Karana means doing. Karana, Kamramna, work. Karana, instrument. Karado, a karikomb. Rebus, Karadi, a turner. Karado, a karikomb. Rebus, Karada, Karade, day book, Marathi. Similarly, Mleda, a twist or a tangle arising in the thread of a cord or a curl or snarl. Rebus, med, iron, copper, Munda, Slavic. Med, Munda, Ho, Santali, med, copper in Slavic languages, Slovak. On another tablet, M1453A, there is a message, in about six Indus-script signs, and a remarkable narrative of a person seated on a stool, flanked by two adherents and also two cobra hoods. The stool, Kando is a stool, Rebus, Kand, furnace, Vikalpa, Kand is a stone, stone metal, ore metal, stone ore metal, could be iron ore. Kamada is a penance, seated in penance posture, Rebus, Kand, stone ore, Rebus, Kambatta, mint. Serpent hoods, Pata, Pata is sharpness, tempered, Padam, tempered, Pada, metals, manufactory. A rimless pot is one of the signs, Bata, Rebus, Bata, smelter, furnace. It appears that the message of the hieroglyphs is about a mint or metal workshop which produces sharpened, tempered iron using stone ore, using a furnace. We can go through the details of all the hieroglyphs in the text message, like Konda, bend, or Kodi, corner, like Adar, splinter, or Sal, splinter, or Rebus, Sal, workshop. As, scales of fish, Rebus, Aya, metal, iron. Kara, wristlets, bangles, Karai, wrist, Rebus, Kar, blacksmith. Dula, pair, Rebus, Dul, metal casting. Rim of a jar, as we have seen, Karnaka, projection of side of a vessel. Karnaka, scribe, an accountant. Karnika, supercargo. Karnaka, a helmsman. Karnamu, he was in charge. He was the active seafaring merchant who was documenting all the cargo and taking it across in cargo boats. So the suggested Rebus readings indicate that the Indus writing served the purpose of artisans and traders to create metalware, stoneware, mineral catalogues, products with which they carried on their life activities in an evolving tin bronze age. Surprise! On October 20, 2020, a remarkable article appeared in the Nature magazine, presented by a group of geneticists, included Ganeshwar Chaube of Benares Hindu University. That October 20 happened to be my 81st birthday. They recorded a remarkable finding. The genetic researchers analyzed 1,437 male samples from South Asia for various novel downstream markers, genetic markers, carefully selected from the extant phylogenetic tree. So, a surprise, we have a remarkable genetic finding reported in the Nature magazine on 20 October 2020, my 81st birthday. This is done by a group of genetic researchers, which included Ganeshwar Chaube of the Benares Hindu University, who has a GAN lab, genetic lab. These genetic researchers analyzed 1,437 male samples from South Asia for various novel downstream genetic markers, carefully selected from the extant phylogenetic tree. With this increased resolution of genetic markers, the researchers were able to identify at least three founder streams to haplogroup O2A M95, which are likely to have been associated with the dispersal of Austroasiatic languages in South Asia. The fourth founder was exclusively present amongst the Tibeto-Burman speakers of Manipur and Bangladesh. In summary, the researchers found and they suggest that the arrival of Austroasiatic languages in South Asia occurred during the last 5,000 years. This remarkable genetic finding finds its parallel and corroboration on Indus-script documentation. Here is a Karen bronze drum, like the Dongsong bronze drum, which shows an elephant, Iba, elephant, Rebus Ib, iron, a tree, Kuti, tree, Rebus Kuti, smelter, a frog, Mukha, frog, Rebus Mukh, ingot. It has on top of the tympanum, sun's rays, Arka, sun's rays, Rebus, Yaraka, metal infusion, Arka, copper gold. It also shows a peacock, Maraka, peacock, Rebus, Marakaka, calcining metal, copper alloy. I submit that the Markmayer speakers were integral to the Meluha Bharatiya Sprakbund language union of Sarasvati Sindhu civilization. These are the speakers who called a fish a Aya, Rebus Aya, iron, Ayas alloy metal, Aya. The Markmayer speakers were integral to the Meluha Bharatiya Sprakbund, the language union of the Sarasvati Sindhu civilization, the spoken language was referred to as Meluha or Mlecha, in which Yudhishthira and Vidura converse during the Jatagriha Parva in the Mahabharata. These are the Meluhas. Look at the map, which shows the dispersal of the Austroasiatic speakers from the Santal Paragana's area, Santali, Mundarika, Ho, and they move into Mankumer region and then get back into the Indian Ocean. Let us now summarize the spectrum of the sources of history, which provide us a framework for analyzing the arts and cultural traditions. Saraswati Sindhu civilization used ligatures in art forms. We have seen the birth of Ganesha as a ligatured form, structure. We have seen Makara, the crocodile, fish, elephant, trunk, combined together into a combined animal called as Makara. Kirtimukha, the fierce tiger face. They are all indescript hieroglyphs. This tradition of writing system, picture writing, Mlechata Vikalpa called by Vatsyayana, or Mlechata Vikalpa mentioned in the Manu, continues as a continuum in the mints of the Panchmar coins and caste coins of with indescript hieroglyphs. This also continues in temples, Tirthasthanas, Pariyatras, started by Sri Balarama along the river Saraswati. We have the cultural traditions of Dharma, Atman as a life principle. We have cultural traditions of yoga and worship. We have also seen contributions to the formation of the gold standard and the dawn of the financial systems of world of nations. We have seen the Varaha, the carnelian ring of Kiradi, and the Varaha of Kajaraho. We also see now from Angkor Wat, stolen sculptures brought back from America, showing in Kurukshetra the Gada Yuddha between Bhima and Duryodhana. These are all remembered memories. In the scene of cultural representation, we see the Pandavas together with Krishna with four hands as witnesses to this great event of the Gada Yuddha, where Bhima revenges the wrong deeds, adharmic deeds of Duryodhana, and destroys him. So what do we see from these sources of history, which are Epigraphia Indica now? They have got implications for language studies. Language X has been postulated by some linguists, and borrowing from Proto-Munda, the Mon-Khmer languages, or Austroasiatic, they can be identified in over 25 ancient Indian languages of India. An Indian lexicon has been compiled with over 8,000 semantic clusters, showing the essential semantic unity and cultural unity of all the Bharatiya languages. The formation and evolution of language X and the differentiation into Prakrits, Pali and other languages of India need to be studied deeper through isoglosses of the linguistic area. The decoding of the Saraswati hieroglyphs establishes firmly the essential cultural continuum of the civilization, which was nurtured principally on the banks of the Vedic river Saraswati, accounting for 80% of the civilizational sites, more than 2000. The continuum is evidenced in language and also in many cultural markers. Look at this cultural marker, seen in about 10 or 11 seals, showing the combination of animals, combined animal architecture. On one we see two animals, a short-horned bull and one-horned young bull and a fish. All these are individually identified as hieroglyphs. They constitute wealthy resources of variety of kinds. These 11 seals are from Mohenjo-daro, Amri, Dwaraka, Dholavira, Biridana, which accounted for Kalibangan. Biridana has shown a continuity of the civilization from the 7th millennium BC. Continuous settlements have been identified, right from a circular living place to rectangular square buildings. Let us go through some of these. Two animals joined together, protons. One horned young bull, head is joined to a short horned bull, and a fish is on top as a sign. The seal is M298. We have seen that one horned young bull represents Shingi Kunda, ornament gold furnace, and the ox is Bharata Bharan, alloy of copper, pewter, and tin. The forward thrusting horn, goat, is Mreka, in case look upon it as a goat instead of a bull. Mreka, male, goat, rebus, Melako, copper. So only two animal heads are joined together in this, whereas in other seals we found three animal heads joined together. With the joining of these two animals, it's being signified that he is an ornament gold worker, an ornament gold goldsmith, and also works with mixed alloys of Bharan and Bharat. 8 copper, 4 zinc, 1 tin. There are 14 underscript inscriptions which have 3 animal heads joined to a bovine body. I suggest that the composition signified 300 Tvashta, a metaphor of Tvashta which is seen in the Rigveda, father of Trisiras, three faces. We have seen on some seals, three faces, Trisiras, three heads, Rebus, Tvashta, Tvashtra, copper, Rebus, Thattara, brass worker, Tvashta, Tuisto, Thattara, brass worker. Together the Trisiras, three headed, is read as Tvashta, father of Trisiras, Rebus, Tvashtra, copper, Thattara, brass worker, Tutur, Thataro, Dantaro, Tatiyar, Tatera, Tatero, Tatero, Tatera, Tateri, Tatera. Variety of pronunciations, but the basic framework is Tatara, brass worker. Three-headed animal, together with two signs of sun's rays, Arka, sun's rays, Arka, copper and gold, Araka, metal infusion. Arkashala, goldsmith's workshop. You have seen the three heads, one antelope, could be Ranku, Arthagara, antelope, Rebus, Ranku, tin, Thagara, tin. The rice plant is Kolmo, Rebus Kolimi, Smithy Forge. Arka sun's rays, you have seen copper, gold, Araka, metal infusion. And it is a series of rays emanating like furrows, Chal, furrows, Rebus, Sal, workshop. So he is representing an Arkashala, a goldsmith workshop working with bronze alloy, indicated by, signified by the forward thrusting horns and antelope, ornament gold with the forward thrusting spiny horn young bull, and Bharat, bison, mixed alloy. So we can see very clearly the Rebus representations were indicators of the wealthy resources with which the artisans were working. For example, the antelope is looking backwards, Karamaramu, Karamara is looking back, Rebus, Kamar means blacksmith. Another seal which shows again the rice plant with the karado, the karikomb symbol combined together. Kolmo is a rice plant, Rebus Kolimi is smithy, karado is a karikomb, karadya is a karikomb, karada is a day book. It also means karada, hard alloy from of iron, silver, etc. And karadi is a tanner. So what he is indicating is that he is now treating this as a day book of activities of the artisans working with alloys of iron, silver, etc. On this seal, the field symbol includes two antelopes, one with a forward thrusting horn, another looking backwards, curving horns backwards, with his heads turned towards backwards to signify Kramara, look back, Rebus, Kamar, blacksmith. Build on the seals, again show three-headed animals, Kramara, looking back, Kamar, blacksmith, and four linear strokes are shown as the sign. Ganda, 4, Rebus, Kanda, implements. Kanda, joint of stock, arrow, Kanda, implements, equipment. This is a semantic determinative of the work that is being documented in this wealth resource documentation. Another seal shows two signs together with the three-headed animal. One is the rim of a jar. We know that it is Kanda Karnaka, fire trench account. Karni supercargo, Karnika, helmsman, merchant man. And we see the backbone, Karada, Karanda, bone shaped like a bamboo, Karandia, backbone, Karada, hard alloy. It could also be Barado, signifying Rebus, Bharata, alloy metal. So we see Karnika, again rim of jar, supercargo, engraver, account keeper, accountant. Again three more symbols from Dholavira, with a man standing with a raised hand, Araka, upraised arm, Araka, metal infusion. Again, same symbols, same meanings. Kar, Kara, wristlet that the man wears. Rebus, Kar, blacksmith. So here are representations of goldsmith, three artificial specialists working with copper tin alloy, ornament gold, and Bharata, alloy metal of copper, zinc and tin. Another seal, Mohenjo-daro 1169, again says the same three animals, but it is a very long inscription, pretty long inscription, it's about 10 plus signs. So the joint parts of the animal are clearly means Sangada, joint parts of animals, Rebus, Sangar, Sangar is a trade. Sangada also can mean a cargo boat. Bharat, Balad, ox, Bharata, fictitious alloy of copper, pewter and tin. Konda and bull, Konda, engraver, turner, Mel, goat, Melaku, copper, Blecha, copper. The goat looking backwards, we have seen, Kamaru, look back, Kamar, blacksmith, Kamaru, Kamar. Thus, the goat with the forward thrusting horns and looking backwards signifies a coppersmith. Let's continue. The signs, 10 signs. All these signs are very clearly demarcations of metalwork catalogs. This thing, Polodu, a bird, bird drongo, black drongo, Polodu means steel. We have seen Ayas, Aya, fish, Ayas, alloy metal. We are seeing a pot with a lid, Bata, rimless pot, Bata, iron, Bata, furnace. And Muka is a ladle, Muha means ingot. So, a furnace being made, used for making ingots. So, the list is very comprehensive, including the fish with a stroke. Stroke is a dhala. Dhalako is a large ingot. So, the sign, the documentation of the Mohenjo-daro seal with the text inscription consistent with the three-headed field symbol or the pictorial motif are consistent with the documentation of metalwork by these artisans. Where does this lead us? We have got about 9,000 Indus-script inscriptions now. How do we analyze it? We have a remarkable analytical tool called the Tantra-yukti, documented by Charak. With the tool was used by great scholars like Panini, who wrote the Ashtadhyayi, Charaka, who wrote the Charaka Samhita, and Kautilya, who wrote the Arthashastra. They used this methodology, consisting of about 40 compositions of textual interpretation, interpretation of phenomena, linking them up together into a research methodology of, called the Tantra-yukti. A string of 40 words in Sanskritam expressions are used. They have been translated into English, reasonably good translations, to indicate how a researcher must expand his doubts and the Purvapaksha and his presentations in the contextual framework of analyzing the words, the expressions in proper context. So the Tantra-yukti is a remarkable dissertation tool which has been used right from the early centuries of the before Common Era by Panini, by Charaka and Kautilya later. All the three of them were present in the great first university of Takshashila. People from all over the world were gathering there to listen to these great masters, to learn from Panini about language and grammar, to learn from Charaka about the herbals and the wealth resources of the trees and forests, and from Kautilya, the organizational competence and establishment of the polity for creating Artha, wealth of nation. Artha also means meaning. Now, let us take a Simhavalokanam at what we have covered so far in these 8 topics. It shows a new floodlight on the Sarasvati Sindhu civilization. I will read out in 6 frames. Over 9,000 inscriptions of Indus script have been added to the Epigraphia Indica to constitute the primary resources for the narration of the history of Bharatam Janam. That's it. 9,000 inscriptions are available today to narrate the history of Bharatam Janam, economic history. Over 80% of the archaeological sites are on the banks of the Vedic river Sarasvati. Hence, it's appropriate to call the civilization Sarasvati Sindhu. The word Hindu is derived from the word Sindhu, which also signifies Sindhan, Hindan, which refer to Sindh cotton from the black cotton soils of the region, Sapta Sindhavaha, an expression used in Rigveda. The Sapta Sindhavaha cotton was in great demand. The Hindu civilization people became the lothiers of the world, supplying cotton goods. Rigveda refers to Hariyupya as the site of 2 Dasaragna wars. First war of 21 kings, second war of 10 kings. One is called the de-dasaragna, second is called Dasaragna. 20 kings, 10 kings. Sarasvati Sindhu civilization is a continuum of the culture detailed in the Rigveda and related ancient texts. Sarasvati river, together with Ganga, Yamuna, Brahmaputra, Mekong, Iravadi, Salween, all Himalayan rivers, was a navigable waterway. Navigable waterway. These navigable waterways complemented the Indian Ocean, which was a critical navigable waterway for the ancient maritime trade. So, the waterways of these great Himalayan rivers and the Indian Ocean constituted the framework structural framework for the ancient maritime trade recorded in these 9000 inscriptions. Tin bronze evolution and the dawn of iron steel age overlaps in the civilizational area. Iron smelting has been archaeologically attested on the Ganga basin sites, Malhar, Rajanalkitila and Lohardiva. Dynamic Himalayas are still in formation stage, arising 1 cm every year due to plate tectonics. This is a cosmic dance metaphor. Plate tectonics have structural control over the hydrological systems of rivers and glacial water flows. The causes for the desiccation of the river Sarasvati caused by plate tectonics and resultant diversions of the Sutlej and Yamuna rivers westwards and eastwards due to tears in the Shivalik ranges have been very clearly proved by researchers. Rakhigadi was the capital of the civilization. It's more than 500 hectares, larger than Mohenjo-daro, located close to Kethri mines as a transshipment point between Brahmaputra, Ganga, Yamuna river navigable waterways, which carried merchandise of tin and iron resources from the ancient forest, and Sarasvati River, which is also a navigable waterway. Rakhigadi was in the central point on the ridge along the Aravalli ranges, which constituted the water divide. Water flowing from the glaciers east of this range, Rakhigadi, flow eastwards. Waters flowing west of the range or trough flow westwards. So this is called the water divide of Rakhigadi. Shivalingas have been discovered in Harappa by Madhusarup paths. Artisans and seafaring merchants have organized themselves into guilds, which evolved as Janapadas, republics, and Mahajanapadas, larger republics, in the historical periods. They also grew into Magadha and Mauryan empires. Artisans and seafaring merchants were Meluha speakers. The Meluha speakers also spread into Markmer speech of the Laos, Vietnam, Cambodia, Thailand. Meluha signifies the Bharatiya Spragbund, the language union or linguistic area, where people from different language families absorbed features from one another and made them their own. University of Hawaii linguists have demonstrated that Markmer languages have roots in Santali, Munda, Austroasiatic languages, which have now been proved on October 20, 2020, genetically also. The same group, same Austroasiatic speakers, moved into the ancient forest. Links of Sarasvati Sindhu civilization with ancient forest region of Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, Malaysia, Thailand, Burma have been proven with the Dongson and Karen bronze drums decorated with Indus-script hieroglyphs. Indus-script is a logographic writing system called Mlechita Vikalpa by Vatsyayana. Each sign, each pictorial motif component is a hieroglyph, red rebus in Meluha. Words to signify the sign or animal and the similar sound rebus, readings of melt resources of minerals, metals, alloys, serapadio artifacts, furnaces, smelters, guilds, guild master, cargo boats. An Indian lexicon has been prepared with words grouped semantically into over 8,000 groups, establishing that from 5th millennium before Common Era, Bharatam Janam or a Spragbund language union, one or more of the present-day Bharatiya languages still contain words used by Meluha artisans and seafaring merchants of the tin, bronze, iron, steel age, firmly anchoring a united Bharatam with a united language speech structure, Spragbund. Three pure tin ingots have been found in a shipwreck in Haifa, Israel. They were inscribed in Indus-script hieroglyphs. An ancient maritime tin route linking ancient Far East and ancient Near East through ancient India of Sarasvati Sindhu civilization trade centers is posited. So the ancient tin route linked Hanoi in Vietnam with Haifa in Israel. Over 90% of the copper used in Eurasia to proclaim the tin bronze revolution came from K3 mines of Rajasthan, Gujarat. This has been proved conclusively by archaeometallurgical provenance analysis. Shalmaneser III obelisk, black obelisk, records tributes which are Indus-script hieroglyphs. A monkey dressed as a woman is a Meluha word, Ratni, which is a red rebus as Ratni, treasure, gems and jewels, wealth. The most frequently used hieroglyphs in Indus-script corpora signify Karnaka, rim of jar, rebus, Karnaka, supercargo, helmsman, scribe, engraver, accountant. Spiny horn, forward thrusting young bull is Konda Singhi, fine gold ornament, gold sacred fire altar, Agrikunda, Kundar, Turner. Standard device is Kunda, fine gold, Kamata, mint. The Indus-script tradition continued into historical periods, evidenced by the Panchmark coins from mints and in cultural friezes. Ganda Berunda signifies ancestral image. Ganda means ancestral image of a Siena bird, Asani thunderbolt, Ahangar blacksmith, Saraba derived from Karaba in the Kentam Satyam breakup of the Indo-European languages is camel, Rebus, Karba iron, Iba is an elephant, Ib is iron, Kolel is a smithy and a forge, Kolel is also a temple, Vyala, Yali, Kola, tigers, Kol, Rebus, coal working in iron, Pola, Zebu, Rebus, Pola, magnetite ore, Polodu, black drango, Polodu, Polad, Polad, Bolad, steel. Thus, iron steel age overlapped tin bronze age. Major contributory factor making ancient Saraswati Sindhu civilization India as the richest nation on the globe, working with natural resources of mineral ores, gem and precious stones, cultivation of wheat, rice, cereals, forest products, cotton and silk clothing, maritime trade, organization of guilds as an economic factor of production. They resulted in the emergence of the shared commonwealth, where wealth produced was shared equitably among all the citizens of the Janapadas and Mahajanapadas and the guilds. The artisans and seafaring merchants organized into guilds to create the wealth of the nation. Provenance analysis had to be done for tin resources, the way it was done for copper, from ancient forest, to conclusively prove that the source of the tin for the tin bronze revolution occurred from ancient Far East. The way the analysis proved that copper came from K3 mines. So the Bharatiya merchants with the merchandise of copper and tin are seen in the shoe ilishu cylinder seal with the signifiers of the goat and the ranku liquid measure, ranku tin. Language studies have to be continued to explain the formation and evolution of all Bharatiya languages from the days of the Bharatiya Spraakbund language union of about 5th millennium before Common Era. The language divide of the so-called Indo-Aryan, Dravidian and Mundarika has been fully falsified. Cultural framework of the civilization continues in a living Indian tradition, Hindu tradition. Wearing of the sindoor, departing of the hair, yoga practices, worship of Shivalinga, veneration of rivers and Tirthasthanas, and firm Adhyatmika foundation of Dharma results in the dictum of Basava, Kaya Kave Kailasa, work is worship, which is the representation of Isavasya Upanishad, famous statement, Tena Tektena Bhunjita. Thus, Saraswati Sindhu civilization was a veneration of the artisans of Bharatam Janam. Yagna is a process of producing wealth, working with mineral resources and sacred fire dharsas, fire altars as furnaces. Yagna is a process of producing wealth. So the imagery of Makara is significant. The word is Makara, composite animal, a unique form of writing system combining hieroglyphs. Rebus, Makara, bellows blower, Dhamaka, blacksmith. The imagery adorns thousands of temple entrances in Bharat. Himalayas constitute the world's greatest water tower. Still growing, still dynamic, still growing by 1 centimeter up. The Indian plate is pushing up at about 6 centimeters per year and pushing northeastwards. The glacial waters should be used to reach out to every home and every farm 24/7 to ensure further economic development and welfare of Bharatam Janam and people of the ancient Far East. Work is ongoing to make Vedic River Saraswati flow again in Bharatam, together with the moving of floodwaters of Brahmaputra to all parts of southern Bharat after Rameshwaram and Shetubandha. This interlinking of rivers has also been approved in a magnificent judgment rendered by three judges headed by Chief Justice of India Kapadia, suggesting that this project must be taken up and monitored personally by the Prime Minister of Bharat. With the disappearment of the Indus-script corpora, researchers have access now to primary sources to narrate the ancient economic history of Bharatam Janam and wealth of nations. This is what we have achieved with this new floodlight on the Saraswati Sindhu civilization. Now let us present an executive summary by recollecting Isavasya Upanishad statement. Isavasya vidam sarvam yatkincha jagatyam jagat tena tyaktena bhujita magrudha kasya siddhanam. What does it mean? all this is for habitation by the supreme divinity. We are only rentiers. The supreme divinity has control over the entire habitation. Whatsoever is individual universe of movement is the universal motion. By that renunciation, thou should enjoy, lust not after anyone's possession. Just earn wealth, share it. Indus is the world's first wealth accounting system. Industrial scale organization of production of tin, bronze and age products resulted along the trading of ancient maritime tin route between Hanoi, Vietnam and Haifa, Israel. Basava translates this Yeshavasya Upanishad statement with this terse expression, Kayakave Kailasa, work is worship. Creating the shared wealth of nation through guilds, artisans governed by Veda traditions of Dharma, Satyam, Tena Taktena Bhunjita, enjoy through sacrifice. As the wealth accounting system for barter trade transactions matured into a monetary system, by about 7th century before Common Era, indescript hieroglyphs continued to be used on ancient mint coins together with Brahmi, Karosti, Greek syllabic scripts. Now we have seen the dawn of a gold standard, which is relatable to the indescript hieroglyphs of fine gold and ornament gold. This is what we have achieved. The indescript is a phenomenal documentation. 9,000 inscriptions is what we have. It's a rich gold mine of resource available for the researchers who can take this forward and narrate this story of a civilization of the Sarasvati Sindhu, Hindu civilization, and energize the youth and enthuse them to work on this work. Don't take whatever has been presented as the final truth. There could be mistakes. So please get engaged, get involved, review, suggest amendments, suggest corrections. Treat this as a pioneering work, as a resource, as a starting point. So further work can be done in language studies and in the analysis of the indescript inscriptions in such a manner that we will be able to present a picture of enormous significance for creating the wealth of nations for the present and future generations. That is the message that these 8 topics that we have presented so far seems to convey. I am beholden to my gurus and all my friends and all the scholars from whom I have learnt a lot. I have stood on their shoulders and taken all these materials from them. Nothing is original. It is all a compilation. I am only an instrument, a nimitta mataram. This is what I have achieved. It is something that can be cherished as the contribution of Bharat, of the ancient civilization, to the rest of the world. The key message is Dharma. Let us understand the significance of this principle of Dharma. It is related to the Atman. Atman is a life principle of sensation. Sensation and life principle, the sensory perception that we have and all that, and what constitutes life. That is Atman. Dharma is an exploration which tries to analyze your own Atman with that Paramatman and try to link up. That is one part of Dharma. Dharma nirapeksha. That is, you achieve nishreyas and you also contribute to the welfare of people. That is Dharma. So this is the tradition documented in our ancient texts. Enormous documentation is available to us. Primary resources are plentiful. All that we have to do is to inquire into it using the Tantra-yukti doctrine and make a presentation in a very simple fashion as possible, as simple a manner as possible, including the presentation through app applications on cell phones. Give it to the world, give it to the children of the globe. Namaskaram, thank you very much for bearing with me for all these episodes presented, which is only a starting point. Namaskaram.